provide certainty in price. It's a significant part of the client experience, but there are several other reasons that it's beneficial to your firm to do this. And to do this, in my belief, that we need to really understand the customer better. A lot of times we fall into roles as order takers. Somebody calls, they said, hey, I need some tax work, some audit work, whatever. And we go, okay, yes, you know, check. And we just set about giving a proposal for that one thing. Instead of asking really deeper and richer questions about what are you trying to accomplish? And can we learn more about your organization? And all that stuff that really moves you into the consultant role instead of the just a vendor box that we often get ourselves stuck in, right? The third part that I'm going to talk about today is customer-centric positioning. I'm going to share with you some examples of, and that link is there again for you. Uh-oh, did I do something? I'm going to share with you some examples of why I think that we're really, really firm-centric and myopic in the way that we present ourselves to our customers instead of being customer-centric and resonating with them at a level that can really take things to the next level for your, not just your sales, but the great, exciting kind of work that you get to do when people buy more than just compliance. How many of you are working on trying to be more business advisor oriented in your firm? Awesome, so it's a really good number. How many of you have customer experience initiatives? A smaller number, but definitely I'd say 10 or 12 of you, thank you. That's helpful to know. So as we move ahead, and by the way, if you guys have questions, stop me, and do we have a runner, George? You're gonna run? Thank you so much for doing that. I appreciate it. Okay, so you might have to speak out because I really can't see. So just holler if you have a question. And did I see a hand? No, okay. Okay, so we're gonna talk about how certainty in price creates confidence in the sense of the buyer. I always say that marketing means showing somebody before they purchase from you that they're making a really wise decision, right? You are making the best decision by hiring me. And then I think that marketing is about showing them all through the project, you made a really wise decision when you hired us. And then I think marketing is, at the end of the project, letting them be reassured that they had made a wise decision. Don't you think as a buyer, you want that reassurance that you made the right choice? You know when you didn't make the right choice with someone that you purchased from, correct? So we need to create an excellent client experience, and we're not always really solid at that. We can get a lot better. One of the ways that has always burned me up is our propensity to bill and duck. It's a term I coined several years ago, and how many of you know what this is? I'm dating myself, right? You just dated yourselves too. Back in the day, we used to have duck and cover drills, and what I mean when I say bill and duck is you quoted somebody, say 25 grand for the audit, looked at your WIP, it was more like 35 grand. You're really nice people, accountants are, they're terrific, they're altruistic, and they go, okay, I'm gonna eat half of it and only invoice 5 grand of the split. So you send the bill, and then you go like this and hope that they don't call you, right? You hope that they just send a check and not make a phone call. That's billing and ducking, and it is a terrible, terrible client experience. We stand here every day and tell our customers something to the effect of, whether it's these exact words or not, that we want to be your trusted advisor, but you can't trust us how much we're going to charge you. And I think it completely erodes trust. So I want to improve on that, and that's why I teach what I teach. It's not about timesheets. It's not about anything else. It's about giving the customer certainty in price, because I believe that that's the appropriate thing to do as a professional. So how do you articulate this to the client when you're, and it's really a business model that's more than a pricing model. It actually changes your whole business model when you do this correctly. What you articulate to the client and what you actually change a little bit operationally about is telling clients we're doing business differently now. It's not a good idea to tell your customer we're charging or pricing differently now. Why would I not want to say that? You what?
They want a credit for the past.
They might want a credit for the past, yeah. But if I said, okay, I'm going to price you differently, that's true. And if I said, I want to price you differently, what's your first concern?
It's going up.
Going up, right. And so that's not the conversation that we want to have. What we want to say is we're doing business a little differently. First of all, we're going to talk to you about what you want to accomplish. Then we're going to show you different ways we can get you to that end. And it might be a little bit, a little more, or a lot. And you're going to have choices. And there's going to be different price points. And you're in complete control of the engagement at any time. That's really the essence of it. And this has to happen through a collaborative pricing process. So picture this. It takes more time. I'm not going to lie to you about anything on this. It takes more time. But picture this. You don't spend time on the WIP on the back end. No more going through WIP for 2 days, 3 days to decide what you're going to charge and what you're going to eat. Your bill is set. Before you start the work, you know exactly how much you're going to charge them and when. In fact, you price a little ahead of the work. So guess what? You have negative AR. You're not financing work anymore. So what you're telling them is we commit to clarity. You will be in complete control of what you buy. But more importantly, you're going to really feel good about why you're buying it. Compliance alone, I have to tell you this, choice. So when somebody has to buy something, audit, tax, what have you, payroll help, whatever, how do they feel about that? Good? Think about when you have to buy car repair or a furnace or you're on taxes. How do you feel about it?
Horrible.
Horrible. And you have no control, right? You get no choice in the matter. You have to do it. So because you have to do it, what things can you control in the process?
Who you choose?
Perfect. Personality, etc. And what else? Essentially how much you're going to pay. That's all the choice you have to exercise. So now what we do, and I don't usually recommend this model of pricing when you're selling a single service, like just tax or just audit. This process is when you're willing to have a conversation with a client, like a business, and understand more about the business and see different ways you can help that business. There's all, I mean, the three buckets, right? People, processes, systems. So if you talk to the HR manager, you might find out about some challenges that they have with staffing and training needs and attitudes and short timers, long timers. You might hear about, I like you to talk to three people in the organization. Talk to the financial person, the business owner, and HR. And talk to them individually, just 20 minutes. Just ask for 20 minutes of their time. You can position it as, when we start working with a company, we like to understand more about you because we want to make sure that anything we do for you is aligned with your objectives, and we need to understand your objectives to make sure that we can meet that goal. So can we talk, can we have, you know, 20 minutes of time with the two other people that you're not talking to first, wherever they are? And guess what? What if they tell you different things and they don't align? What could they possibly be in need of that your firm could do? Oh, come on, guys. Strategic planning, right? If there's if there's misalignments, you can help them strategically. So they need to understand why they're buying it. The next thing is nobody likes surprises, so certainty in price is helpful, and delivery. They don't care how long it took you to do the work ever. They only care about the fact that they got it when you said you were going to give it to them. How long it took you between now and then is irrelevant. That's your problem. Not their problem. So just meeting your basic commitment. The only reason, if a client says no, how many hours are you going to spend in an RFP? Why are they asking you that? Because that's how you charge. But if you're not charging that way, the question is irrelevant. Say, don't worry about that. That's our problem, not your problem. We'll spend as much time as it takes. So there's 5 C's I have for creating options. These are the 5 advantages for using an options approach in your pricing.